Good morning, Biscuit babies. Today we got a very special guest joining the Biscuit, Riley Cote, Philadelphia Flyers alumni, co-founder of Athletes for Care, advocate for hemp, all-around badass. I'm very excited to have him on and talk to him today. I'm sure you guys will love it. As always, the episode of The Biscuit is brought to you by Flucid Lote Spas out of Mount Vernon, Ohio. It is a deprivation tank where you go and you get in the tank. It's got like salt water in it. It releases all the pressure from your joints and all that good shit. And it really helps with self-reflecting and pain and inflammation and everything that is good for mental and physical health. So make sure you go there. Talk to Chad, maybe get a massage, let him know the Biscuit sent you, and you can get your first float for half off, which you can't beat. I think it ends up being like $30. You won't be able to float anywhere in America for that price. So you might as well go try it one time and, you know, see if you like it or not and go back. We are also partnered up with ParkersPlatoon.org. Scott the Sheriff Parker, former Colorado Avalanche Stanley Cup champion, and his wife and son have started a nonprofit organization for the to help veterans when they come home to acclimate back into normal, being a citizen after going to war and training and, you know, seeing the things and doing the things they've had to do. It's not always easy. And, Scott cares a lot about our military, so he takes care of them, boys. So go there, donate. Buy some CBD oil. I've been taking my CBD oil 3 times a day, baby, and I feel way better. I'm sleeping better. I'm actually waking up and getting like going better. I wake up at 4. I take my active CBD. I go for a walk down the river. When I get home later that day, I take a little bit of the elite CBD. Take a shower. Feel better, and then when I'm going to bed, I take a little bit of the pro just to help me wind down a little bit, and I can tell a difference. It works. Science, check it out. All right, guys, Riley Cote.
Now he's loose with the right hand, and he starts to retaliate, and down goes Nyland, and the two of them are hammering each other.
Knights of Columbus, that hurt.
It's old time hockey.
Enforcer of all hockey podcasts. It's the Biscuit. It's the Biscuit.
Damn it! The school regulation size of what?
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts.
God help the fucking day if fighting's ever banned. As a country will stop working on some badness fucking can.
Hi everybody. It's the Biscuit Podcast.
Hey, you wanna go? Yeah, okay.
All right, Biscuit babies, I'm joined today with a very, very special guest, Philadelphia Flyer alumni, co-founder of Athletes for Care, educator, coach, public speaker, advocate of hemp, a healer, an amateur tattoo artist, a father, a husband, and all-around badass, Riley Cote. How you doing, buddy?
Doing well, thanks. Thanks for the intro.
Hey, of course, man. Hey, before we get started, I just want to say, from all the fans of the Biscuit and myself personally, thank you for what you did in the NHL and, you know, protecting your teammates and risking your health for, my entertainment and the safety of the players around you. We appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks. Appreciate that. It's always nice to hear from that perspective. It's something I decided to do when I turned 20 years old to take on that role. So it was obviously a personal choice. No one ever forced me to do it, but it was good while it lasted. You learn a lot about yourself and learn a lot about team culture with the element of self-policing and accountability. So it's a powerful thing.
Now, you said when you were 20, you decided, was it kind of a self-preservation thing? Like, if I want to go further in my hockey career, this is what I'm going to kind of have to do?
Exactly, yeah. I was never drafted. I went through 4 years of junior hockey in the Western Hockey League. I put up, decent numbers my last 2 years, 28 goals my last year, but, nothing, significant to go up against the best, goal scorers and offensive guys in the world. So that was when I realized I had to do something a little bit different and just get noticed on a daily basis. And, I was a physical guy, I was a competitive guy, so I knew I could at least attempt to take on the challenge. So it was something I really had learned, basically, like I said, like when 20 years old, I just started fighting everyone and their brother. After the biggest guy and the guy with the most penalty minutes on every team, and, the rest is history.
Yeah, it's true. I mean, especially in the NHL, if you go down the guys you fought, it's insane. I mean, Cam Jansen, Asham, Rupper, Andre Waz, Thornton, McGranton, Thorburn, LaRocque, Peros, Jody Shelley, Pierre-Luc LeBlanc, which seemed like you guys fought every game. Gilles, Goudard, McIntyre, Bielak. I mean, every single – any tough guy you could think of that era, you dropped him with them. I mean, that's remarkable.
Yeah, I wasn't in a choice to – in a position to say no, So I think I was an undersized guy. I mean, I think I had the heart to take on anyone. I wasn't in a position to say, well, I know you're too big, you're too tough, I'm not going to fight you. Once you kind of establish a name for yourself in a sense and – people recognize you as a little bit of a threat, then people start come knocking on your door. And I wasn't in a position to say no. I just accepted it for what it was and just took on all comers, And I think the first few years I did it, I really enjoyed it. It was a new challenge for me, and it was just kind of like I created my own, my own identity in a sense. And, and the guys that I kind of grew up watching, like LaRocque and Brashear, never would I thought I'd be fighting these guys, for a living and trying to, make a career out of it. So interesting how life works sometimes, but, it's all about survival. And, for me, it was really wanting to accomplish my goal and my dream of playing in the NHL. And I didn't know any other way of getting that done except for this way. So it was just, it was business.
Now, before that day where you decided, I'm going to start, I'm going to fight my way into the NHL, were you into fighting at all, or a physical guy or a violent guy? Or was it just that day it had to happen and then started and you're like, oh, I'm kind of good at this?
Yeah, I'm not a violent guy. I think I've been in two street fights my whole life, and they're both just kind of getting involved with my buddies' extracurricular activities. But a peaceful guy. I've been in, I think my first year in junior when I was 16, I fought the most out of all my junior hockey career. And I think it was maybe 8-9 times. And I did pretty well, but I was 16 years old, and I wasn't fighting heavyweights either. So, and then going into my next couple of years, I think the fights landed up lessening, but I also started fighting bigger, tougher guys when I had to. I became the captain, and, I think a couple of times that year I fought the tough guy just to kind of send a message. I think I had it in me,
yeah.
But I think I wasn't accepting at that moment that, that was going to be actually my role on a team, and that was the way I was going to find my way. I think I hadn't discovered that in me yet. Because again, back then in the Western League, there was still, a lot of legit heavyweights kicking around, Goddard and Parker and Fedorik and McIntyre and Bugar and all these guys. So these guys existed back then. And, I wasn't in the business of fighting those guys then, and then it wasn't until I realized I had to do it. Then it was just like, I was welcoming of it. It was business. It doesn't matter who I played. There was a big guy on the other team, and there's a guy that was an experienced fighter, and whether it was in the American Hockey League, Central Hockey League, East Coast Hockey League, or the NHL, it was flooded with mutants.
Yeah, you were out there when it was still the Wild West out there. I mean, like you mentioned, some of the just killers out there in the league. Another just remarkable thing about your journey to the NHL is, very few hockey players get to play in the NHL. Even fewer get in there undrafted. What was that like going into, were you invited to camp and just went there and just showed your stuff and got in?
Something like that. So not being drafted, I'd been invited to a bunch of different camps. I think the year my draft year when I was not invited, it was the first year Minnesota Wild was in the league. So I went to Minnesota Wild camp. The following year I went to Columbus Blue Jackets camp, 19, yep. 20. I went to Toronto Maple Leafs training camp, and that's when I signed a contract with their minor league team, St. John's Maple Leafs at the time, and spent that year. That's when I turned pro and spent it in the Central Hockey League. The next fall, the following year, went back to Columbus Blue Jackets training camp, landed up in Syracuse in the American Hockey League a little bit, and then spent most of the year in Dayton in the East Coast Hockey League. And then, from there, the following year, I actually didn't go to training camp because there was no training camp in 2004, right. 2005 season. I went back to my original Central Hockey League team. I was there for like 3 or 4 days, and then that's when Ron Hextall, at the time, he was like the assistant GM of the Phantoms back then, called me up and said, "We're going to sign you to a 25-game professional tryout agreement." And, the rest is history. We ended up winning the Calder Cup that year. I think I led the team in penalty minutes and just had an opportunity to play. It was a couple injuries, and it was just a mixture of opportunity and a great team we played on, and found my niche from there. And then I signed a contract with Bobby Clark there, a two-way contract, and kept fighting and doing my thing, and eventually got a call up and kind of stuck around.
Yeah, I think one of the best photos in Calder Cup trophy history is you in the locker room with that thing. You look like something out of like Friday the 13th, just jacked out of your gills, like holding the cup up, just massive. It's a badass picture.
it was a good time, great experience, and for my first year in Philly there, I mean that was certainly the foundation of my success, because teams want winners. I come in there as a I signed four professional tryouts that year, called PTOs, and so I didn't even have a real contract that whole year. To do it way, it was just kind of like meant to be. I fit into the culture of Philly and the Flyers and the Broad Street Bullies, just with the way I was wired, and it was a perfect fit for sure, no question.
Definitely, and that's a one thing, if you go back and listen to interviews of anyone that's ever played with you, or any of the coaches that have had you on their line or team, all of them just glory to your work ethic, first guy in the rink, last guy to leave, in the gym with the guys. Is that something you just like, being around the boys and just working hard, or was it like, you didn't even think about it? That's just how you are. Because especially, you're a little leaner these days, but you were a huge dude. I always go, there's no way he only weighed 210 pounds. He was massive.
Yeah, going back to the first part of it is, I just love to train and work out and be in the gym, and then I also naturally just love being around guys. So it was a perfect marriage. So it wasn't like I didn't feel like I was going out of my way to being something I wasn't. So that role kind of just naturally, it was just a natural fit, And I lifted a lot of weights. I trained poorly. When you think about like the science behind it, a lot of heavy lifting and slowing my fast twitch muscles down, and now I look back on it and see a lot of flaws in what I did, but I was my heart was in the right place. I was trying to do the right thing. I love being in the gym. I always thought I was actually improving. I think even though sometimes I probably wasn't improving because of some of this exercise I was doing, in my mind I thought I was improving. So I think that was just the heart and the spirit of it all was, probably why I was there. I think, a lot of people just saw me just as a guy that, cared about his teammates, but just wanted to be the best I could be and tried my hardest. And so I think it rubs off. And if you see someone doing that religiously, you can't help but to look and notice.
Oh, it's infectious for sure. You don't want to be the bitch in the locker room while that dude's doing fucking deadlifts all day, and you're in there going, I just want to go home and play video games or something.
Yeah, exactly. And I didn't even think of it like that at the time. I wasn't like consciously waking up anymore every morning and saying, "Oh, I got to lead by example and I'm going to do this." It was just like, that was just the only way I knew to do it. I was ingrained at a young age to get up early and work. I had a paper route in Winnipeg, Manitoba for 5 years, of like 8 years old to 13 years old, delivering papers at 5:30 in the morning. So I understand what, the struggle, and I understand the, the grind it takes to do that. So I wasn't, even though that was ingrained into my way of life, I didn't think of it as, I didn't think of it like that. Like I was actually – something positive that everyone else wasn't doing.
That had to have been some cold mornings getting out there in Manitoba and taking the paper.
I can't believe I actually did that.
I'm cold just thinking of that idea.
Environment, you don't even think anything of it. Now living in the U.S. the last 16 years, and I'm outside of Philly where we still get obviously cold in the winter, but nothing like Winnipeg where now I look back, I go to Winnipeg and be like, wow, there's no way I could get up at 5:30 in the morning. And so what are they doing?
They probably don't even let kids do it anymore. There's probably some weird robot.
You're absolutely right. There's all kinds of stuff involved now.
And you talk about, you know, lifting in those days, the information wasn't as readily available to athletes as it is now. I mean, the players now, they have a lot more information, you know, maybe through the trials and tribulations of guys like you that had to go through that and be like, oh, well, you know, maybe you don't have to, you know, just deadlift and do clings all day. There's other things you can do with like a medicine ball to, you know, like you said, work your fast switch muscles and prolong your career. But you guys definitely did the best with the knowledge that was available at that time.
No, you're absolutely right. If you look back to the history of just training and within the hockey space, specifically, like say the Flyers, I mean, they won two Stanley Cups in the 70s, and they didn't train. You know what I mean? Like, they came to training camp to get in shape. They drank beer. You know? I'm not downplaying the vitamins. It's not a negative thing, but you want to look at the evolution of, like, the, you know, conscious training. And then even you get into, like, you know, the early 90s. I mean, they started training, I think, you know, in the 80s and stuff like that, but it was just a lot of, you know, running, coming to training camp to get in shape. And then, you know, early 90s, now you're getting into some heavy weights. And, you know, late 90s, it's, you know, there's still heavy weights going around. And then all of a sudden, it's like, now all of a sudden there was some mindfulness going around. Like, my last 2 years, it was very, very sports specific to hockey,
yeah,
which makes total sense. It should be. You know what I mean? As far as being lean, being quick, being efficient for a hockey player. And I look at, you know, myself specifically, that I, you know, I consciously was gaining weight, trying to gain weight to fight bigger dudes, but I was sacrificing mobility, quickness, agility, you know, the whole bit. Where, you know, a UFC fighter is probably the most functional and best shape athletes on the planet, arguably, right. Actually cut weight and lean up to move down weight classes. So, you know, a lot of the stuff I was doing was counterintuitive, you know, knowing I was knowingly doing it, but I didn't realize how much effect it had on my functionality as an actual hockey player, because I was so driven and focused on the fighting aspect of it that I almost forgot about being a hockey player, to tell you the honest truth.
Oh, yeah. You can look at some UFC guys and they look like – and I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but they look like they could be pumping your gas. But they work you two ways to Sunday if you even, you know, try to go for a jog with them.
That's exactly it, yeah. And, you know, that's what I've learned too is – you know, especially playing the role, is that there's a lot of big dudes out there. There's a lot of big dudes with no bite. You know what I mean?
Right.
From like outside looking in, you know, the average person looks at this guy and be like, well, this guy's scary, must be tough, must be mean. I can't tell you how many times I've proven that to be false when you call someone's bluff and you make someone accountable that they don't want nothing to do with it.
Oh, yeah.
On the other hand, you got a guy that, like you said, like it looks like the average Joe that looks like he's, you know, like looks like he's absolutely nothing, and you know, and he's the guy that could, you know, run around you three times and smoke you in the head 20 times before you even, you know, got a punch. And so, you know, it's really that. It's an attitude. Toughness is nothing more than an attitude. You know what I mean? And
yeah.
If you have the attitude, and then you mix that with, you know, the proper tools and elements of training and, you know, conditioning your body and being functional, being efficient, like that's when guys get scary tough.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, the guys like McGregor and some of these high-end UFC guys were like, they got a lot of anger. They got a lot of, you know, they got the attitude. They got the rage. They got the warrior mentality. And then all of a sudden, now you become an elite athlete in conjunction with that, just functionality-wise and training-wise. And all of a sudden, it's like, now you're the best in the world, right? I mean, it's
for sure.
It's a pretty amazing thing.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've seen 6'8" walking pussies, basically, where just like it's easy to be, you know, talk shit at that point when you're 6'8", but then when someone checks your bluff, like you said, you know, he shrinks real quick.
Yeah. And, oh, yeah. It's, yeah, you're absolutely right. And you see it all the time. And those guys have probably never been challenged their whole life because they've been big.
Oh, yeah.
And then, and when they do get challenged, they don't know what to do because they're almost like, well, what? Like, someone's actually wants to fight me? And then,
oh, you can tell. You can tell too when you get an altercation. If that person's never been punched in the face, you can see it in their eyes. You're like, oh, you've never been hit. I mean, you're getting into something that you don't want to start here.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Yeah, you learn a lot about an individual when there's accountable situations, specifically in hockey. When, you know, when it's time to man up and, you know, and take care of business, you see, you know, a lot of true colors in people, especially with the guys that are running their mouth and acting tough. But then when it comes down to, you know, accepting a challenge, they're not willing because, I mean, again, they're really not mentally that tough. Because,
and now, I mean, if someone bumped into you on the street, and I mean, you're, like you said, you're a very nice, non-expecting guy. You know, very nice to anybody. I mean, but nobody knows, especially today, like who's taking jiu-jitsu or, you know, who's like, you have to be very mindful of, which is a good thing, of what you're saying to people and how you treat people now, which I think is a great thing that finally happened, where people are realizing like, oh, that guy might be able to choke me out.
Yeah. You're exactly right. And I think there needs to be more respect for that exact reason. It's that you shouldn't be having to walk down the street and be like, well, I'm not going to be an asshole because that guy's around.
Right.
I'm going to be an asshole because he's not around. You know what I mean? That's what happens in hockey, and that's pretty much the reason why there's, you know, it has been enforcers and tough guys to take care of business to begin with. But in the real world, if you have that attitude, you're just a total asshole.
Because, yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like you should be treating the janitor the same way as you treat your wife or your boss or, you know, a co-worker, you know what I mean? So you shouldn't have to wean through life and say, well, I'm going to walk on eggshells because that guy's tough, and I'm going to act like a jackass around this guy because he's not tough and he's not going to say anything. You know what I mean? I think that's a poor attitude that a lot of people do have. And I wish that, you know, life kind of smacked those people in the face a little bit where they did piss off the wrong guy and the guy smoked them in the mouth. And I'm not warning from violence, but sometimes violence has its place to help people learn.
For sure.
You know what I mean? You'll learn a lot by getting smacked in the mouth. I can assure you that.
It's almost the best lesson in life is getting checked in the face real quick. It'll be like, oh, maybe I shouldn't, you know, be, you know, walking around with my chest pumped out when there's no reason for it. Why can't we all just enjoy this concert, say, you know, that everybody can come here and have a good time. There doesn't have to be one prick trying to peacock all over the place.
Yeah, that's what we all hope for. It's just unrealistic. There's too much ego in this world.
Yeah.
There's just too much entitlement, and, you know, and the way society's going is just, we've become such a soft breed. We there's no truth anymore. People get offended by the truth, and when you try and be honest with people, they feel like you're breaking them down, or you're attacking them, and you know, there's the old school way, like, and I'm kind of integrated new school as well, because I understand that you have to evolve with times, and you look at just coaching, was they used to demean guys and tell guys, you know, basically they're the scum of the earth and they were the worst hockey players. You could send them to the minor leagues. And now it's all about teaching and, you know what I mean? And helping these guys and just giving these guys all these resources and totally different approach. But I mean, somewhere along the lines, you see these young guys coming into pro hockey now that they've lost. There's almost like the entitlement factor is so high. They've lost that ingredient of having to earn something. Because they've just been the best at what they've been doing their whole life, and they haven't actually had to be a cut from a team. There's never been that adversity or struggle, and then all of a sudden it's like, whoa, what's happening? Everyone's giving up on me, and because they've never, you know what I mean? And because they had someone tell them they're not good enough to play tonight.
Yeah.
You're not good enough, so we're going to take your lineup. We're going to put you in the stands tonight. You know, and all of a sudden it's like a personal attack, and now I spent the last 7 years coddling guys, and they're scratched out of the lineup. It's like,
yeah.
Where's the ownership on you to be better? Like, you know what I mean? Yeah, you were the best on your team in the Quebec League or the, you know, Ontario League or wherever you came from. So was everybody else on this team.
Exactly.
Best player. So now where do you fit in? Now you got to find an identity. Now you're going to deal with some struggle and adversity. Now we're going to see how tough mentally you really are. But, you know, that should be ingrained from parenting and, you know, from younger ages. Now we're just walking on eggshells around our children because we don't want to offend them.
Yeah. that taste of fear, you can see that it's missing. And when you see guys like, I mean, for instance, I don't know if you still watch the league presently, but like Nazem Kadri the other day takes a run at a dude on his knees on the boards. And Chara just comes up to him and like says, hey, you shouldn't have done that.
Yeah.
What kind of bullshit is that? I think it was Wiggins, almost ended his career. I mean, very easily could have. Someone's neck into a board like that is nothing to play with. And, you know, you always hear, you know, Char's the baddest mother, but, I mean, he just came up and, like, patty-caked him. I was like, dude, think about if you were in your Flyer days, if somebody would have done that to one of your teammates, you wouldn't have been skating up to him saying, how do you do?
Well, that's exactly it. I think that shows you like the attitude, how the attitude has changed. And I'm not downplaying Chara. Like, as far as the baddest dude, yeah, he's 6'9", 270 pounds. Like, who wants to fight that dude?
Right.
But also just skating around like a like a big animal and trying to intimidate guys doesn't work anymore. You actually have to execute. So like in a situation like that, that would be, especially a guy that's been around
forever,
since the old times.
67, I think, was his rookie year.
Like send a message. Maybe take an extra 2-minute penalty in this situation. But we've almost played these politics of the rules so perfectly. Where now we're just like, oh, let's not touch him because we're not going to waste our power play and blah blah blah. Where it's like, there is certain situations that have to be dealt with, and I'm not Zdeno Chara tough. You know what I mean? He'd probably stick a pole through my face, but I would stand up to him. Yeah, I can assure you that. And if that happened in front of me, I can assure you I would have done something. You know, there's a time and a place to send a message, because that's more powerful than sitting back there and evening up the power play or going on the power play for one time. Yes, I'm not saying be undisciplined, but sometimes
there's
situations like that become more valuable energy-wise for your team and the building because you're doing the right thing.
To me, that is the perfect example of it, it seems like the situation where you can send a message to not only the fans but the opposing team and the playoffs from that point on, going, hey, this shit will not happen. I'll take a penalty for this because this is how I believe. I'm not that worried about a power play at this situation because you just tried to kill one of my teammates. So now I'm going to have to punch you in the face and make sure that this shit doesn't continue. This cannot happen. But you made a great point in saying the rules – almost, you know, we've talked a little bit about just life itself and society. The everybody is so afraid of the rules, and that was something. I mean, you've always pushed against like anything where they're like, "Well, no, you can't do that. You can't make the NHL if you're undrafted. You can't use hemp or marijuana to heal." And you know, you would just stick up, take your shirt off, and be like, "Nah, bro, I'm gonna do what I want. You know, I'm going to do what is best for, you know, Riley Cote, my family, my teammates, et cetera."
Yep.
There's a lack of what's the word I'm looking for here? Where they're just afraid, it seems like. They're so afraid of a power play. 2 minutes.
Yeah, you know, and I think that comes back to just they instill fear into you to kind of control your behavior. So in society, they instill fear in you where, you know, they dangle, prison time and, you know, justice system and, you know, losing your job and drug testing. So it's very real stuff. I mean, it can affect your life. There's no question. And they funnel you down this other way. And then, you know, in sports here now, they put all these rules in and all these suspensions in, all really in the name of trying to remove concussions, I think, is really where it stems from. But what you see is even more of a lack of respect in hockey. You don't see you didn't see these types of things happen.
You didn't.
With Tony Twist and Paul Probert and Kelly Chase and all these dudes back in the day, before my time even, were around. Like, you didn't see that stuff happen because you know, the barbaric nature of what people, think that fighting breeds is that it breeds respect, and it breeds a mutual respect amongst the fighters themselves, but amongst the teams, which brings a sense of peace. We'll go about our business here now and finish up the game in a respectful manner. When you remove the element of accountability, like, even though you can still fight in NHL, it shows you right there on your example with Chara, is that, like, he's the biggest, baddest dude in NHL. He could have literally flexed his muscle and sent a message across their, you know, the opposing team's dressing room and saying, "Well, wow, this means business.
Yeah,
we're in a series here, and you know, like, we can't screw around with this guy." But like, no, he doesn't do that, and that shows you like there's no accountability. So like Kadri, like, I mean, you know, he's walking around like, "Well, I can do whatever I want. No one's gonna really do anything."
Yeah.
Let's go on the power play, guys.
Yeah.
So it's that element, that's shit, that's a totally different way of thinking, because there's no one to answer to now.
Yeah.
I'll just turtle and go on the power play. Well, what is that? You know what I mean? It shows you how much of a lack of respect there is in the game. That's why some of your superstars are dealing with concussions. I mean, I don't know how many Crosby's had, and I know there's been some tough guys over there, but it's really the element of the tough guy and the role. You've stripped him of his abilities to be a tough guy.
Right.
rules you put in. So right. That's why teams don't carry guys anymore. Really,
and if you look at the years where Crosby's really suffered and been out, he didn't have those guys with him. Yeah, he's had a new age enforcer sprinkled in here and there through his career. But those years where he's really taken it, he didn't have those guys. They weren't there.
Yeah, and that just shows you. I mean, it's just like if you have a guy around that's unpredictable, if you want to call it that, or you're just not sure what he's going to do, like that's what's more scary than a 6'9" guy that's 270 pounds to me, is a guy that's unpredictable.
Yeah.
And you know what I mean? And a guy like Chara is pretty predictable because he's a pretty peaceful guy. Like, you have to really, really egg him on. I remember even back when I was playing against him, like, I was calling him every name in the book and just to get pissed off. But I understand his side of it. He's like, why would I fight this guy? Because, it's a bad trade-off. So, I understand both sides. Right. But nonetheless, like, again, there's situations in life and in hockey that are very apparent in times that you have to take care of business. Like, most of the time, it's black or white. It's just like, now is the time, boys. Like, oh, yeah. You know what I mean? If I was floating around the ice and I saw my line mate, Jim Dowd, my first year playing, get crushed, I wouldn't have to think about it. I wouldn't have to be like, even if it's playoffs, I'd be like, this is business. Like, we have to stick up for our guys, collectively, to advance into the next game and the next game and win a series here. You know what I mean? That sets the tone for the series.
And you would think if you're thinking that and I'm thinking that, with Chara wearing the C on his sweater, everyone else on that bench was probably going, oh, yeah, here comes Captain, taking care of it. And then, I mean, maybe it lets the air out of the tires a little bit, too, at that point. Like, oh, shit.
It's exactly that. You can't quantify that. You know what I mean? You can't – energy is something very, very powerful where, you've been in a building before where there's a fight or a hit, and, like, the amount of energy it creates, like
– Oh, it's
the other side of the coin is where, like, it builds up. It's going to be a fight. And the fight don't happen, and all of a sudden it's like, man, you know what I mean? It's like, it's just like, why didn't it? And I get it. It's a new age NHL, but there's still times, in my opinion, that there's circumstances that warrant that type of behavior.
100%. You know what
I mean? It goes a long way because the whole team's going to be just fueled by it, the whole building. I mean, I don't know if that game was in Toronto or wherever the hell that was, but it doesn't matter.
Because it doesn't matter, right?
It doesn't matter. Both sides of the fans feel it. And and my money's on Char on that one. It's not going to be an even fight by any means. And Kaji will change his behavior pattern the rest of that series. I can assure you that.
Oh yeah,
that's what accountability does, and that's anybody will tell you that. You know what I mean? And but the average fan just can't understand that power of fear. When you instill fear in someone, an unpredictable fear, people. Oof. Change their behaviors. And there's no question. It's so obvious. And I lived it. You know what I mean? I challenged that on a daily basis. So I always say, like, when I was in scrums or if I was on the ice, like 90% of the guys, if I asked them to fight and got in their face, they wouldn't even like respond to me. They would just turn the other way. And then maybe 5% of them would look me back in the eye and maybe push me back and act tough a little bit. Maybe 3% of those of the remaining five will actually fight me if I push the envelope. And then there's back then, maybe about 1 or 2% that were like, the guys that are gamers every night that would certainly fight me, no question. But you learn a lot about the human mind and the attitude is when you engage in, accountability and challenging someone mentally where they're forced to either go away and change their behavior or fight me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I know it sounds like Roman Empire-ish, but it's very real. You know what I mean? And I'm again a respectful person. I don't go around flexing my muscle. But if something needs to be done while I was walking down the street with my daughter, and someone, you know what I mean? It would be the same thing as when I was on the ice. Like, I have to make a decision to help someone or stick up for someone or make a decision to maybe flex my muscle now because I feel threatened, my daughter feels threatened, whatever it is, you know what I mean?
Right.
And, but that element, once you remove that, it's just a game with no respect now because now everyone's a tough guy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And in the real world, there's a hierarchy, whether you like it or not.
Yeah, period. And that's just the black and white facts. There's a hierarchy. That's just the way shit happens sometimes.
On your dog, man. That's the world we live in. So it's like only the strong survive. Or, you know what I mean? It's like, sometimes you have to do something you don't want to do to survive and get by and earn your respect. You know what I mean? Like,
well, I knew
most nights when I was fighting guys weight in my weight class, there probably wasn't a good chance that I'd win. But on the other side of it, I also knew that if I didn't, I would lose respect for my team and the fans. But showing up and doing it on a nightly basis, or at least attempting to on the nights I didn't fight, like, you know, it goes a long way as far as earning respect and, like, even from the opponent, because this guy's like, even though I didn't fight, it'd be like, this guy's still trying to do this, and it's like,
yeah,
it's being relentless, and you know, it's a powerful thing because it's energy, and you can't quantify it, but it's a respect, and respect is energy, and it, to me, it's like, there's not a whole lot of it left anymore. You know what I mean? And most of the concussions, I think, from, you know, Ice Guardians. Stats is under 5% of concussions come from fighting. So,
right,
where the other 96% of these concussions coming from? It's not the fights. It's the cheap shots. It's the blind sides. It's the shoulders to the jaw, whiplash, or whatever else. You know,
it comes from the shit that fights stop.
Exactly. That's exactly it.
Now, I really want to touch on two things you said in there that I thought are absolutely brilliant. The first being, you had mentioned unpredictable fear, which if you don't put that on a t-shirt with your face, I'm going to. There's something to that. There, that being out there and where you've got this X factor dude. Yeah, he might not drop 30 goals in a season, but there's not a stat bar for the fear, that unpredictable fear that he's instilling across that rink. I mean,
Yep. And
you mentioned it. You can feel it as a fan. You're going, oh, dude, 33. Watch out for that guy. You can see that they're, and it goes to this, the whole thing now where every goal somebody's crying about goalie interference. When, you know, your buddy, my buddy Scott Parker used to put himself in front of that crease, there was no goalie interference. You didn't touch his goalie. Nobody touched anybody. You didn't do shit. You tried to score and then waited for him to get off the ice.
Yep.
And that's another thing in the stat bar that I wanted you mentioned too is momentum. You can't measure it, and a fight will swing momentum hard, very hard.
Yeah, especially if it's a fight that's so obvious to everyone in the stands that, like, something needs to be done. You know, what I mean? There's a lot of fights that most people don't even understand where they started from, or they kind of have behind the play. But, like, something that's so blatantly obvious to both sides and all fans across, you know, North America here and the world, like, those are the times that it's even more powerful because everybody knows, and everybody knows you should have acted on it. So on the other side, you say energy, it's almost like taking the wind out of the sail in a sense, where it's almost like, damn, Char, like, come on, buddy, buck up. Like, this is just a time. It would take you two punches.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Just two punches and go sit in the penalty box, and you'll get the world's support because you did the right thing.
Yeah, and your PK is going to be riding off those two punches anyhow, so chances are you're not getting a goal on that power play anyhow because the boys are going to be so riled up, it won't matter.
Yeah.
It just won't matter. I wanted to talk to you a little about – I've had Adam Scorgi and Scott Parker on the show on the podcast, and I just wanted to ask you about how that experience of being in Ice Guardians, and you're a very introspective guy from the short conversations I've had with you, just, and I don't think people thought of you or the enforcers from the league and in that time that like that, where guys were just like, oh, these guys are mutants just going out there and fighting, but you guys really thought about the process and what your fist and your actions were doing and how it would, you know, swing momentum or make your teammates feel, or how it could change a game or stop, you know, somebody getting hurt. As a kid, I didn't notice it. I just thought it was badass. But when you watch something like Ice Guardians and you realize, like, oh, holy shit, there's a whole science to what these guys were doing. You can't, that film is so remarkable and so important to hockey and sports and human life, period. I just wanted to know what you thought of the film after it came out and your experience recording it or filming it.
Yeah, I mean, I thought it was an unbelievable film and really, really portrayed the role and these players in the light that they deserve to be portrayed in. So I thought it was very well done. You know, again, I think most hockey fans really don't understand the depth of the role and understand, you know, why it ever was part of the game. And I think watching it certainly bring some clarity to that. Scorgi hit me up, I think, like 6 years ago on social media. This is way before he even got approval of the NHL. I think it took him like 3 or 4 years.
Oh, yeah.
Approval, maybe longer, maybe 5 or 6 years. And, you know, he told me about the idea and the guys get involved. And, you know, I said I can share my resources and contacts to anybody that you might want to get involved in. So I shared a couple, you know, emails and phone numbers with him. But awesome guy. And he has a real tight connection with Todd Fedoric in Kelowna as well as Scott Parker. So we had some mutual friends. But it was, you know, I knew from speaking with him, he had done some other documentaries that I was a huge fan of in the cannabis space, The Culture High and the business behind Getting High, which were really well done and informative. So I knew he would do a good job with it. But again, I think the role had never been explained like that, you know, in real time and with real people and real stories to kind of connect the dots of the actual role itself. So I thought it was really well. I haven't heard anything negative about it. To tell you the honest truth, it's been nothing but positive, and the story needed to be told. You know, it kind of brings clarity, like sure said, to understanding where these guys come from, and bringing some humility into it. Because I think a lot of guys just think of us as, you know, warriors that you know, that whatever, just our meatheads. That you look at guys like Peros, and you know, coming down to Princeton. There's obviously calculated risk involved, and you know, and like for myself, I realized that, you know, I had to do this. There was no other choice. Otherwise, I'd have been in the minor leagues my whole life, which there's nothing wrong with that. But I was driven to find my way. So, you know, everyone's different. Everyone's wired a little bit different. The role isn't for everyone. There's no question. But you know, especially when you know, see a bunch of guys talk about it, and you know, the anxieties that are brought on, and you know, the mental part of it. It's not easy. It's not easy and normal to get up every morning and fight prepared to on a nightly basis. You know, the whole fight or flight response in life is generally one or the other. You pick one and you deal with it. But when it's like constant, when you're constantly thinking about it, especially in hockey where you don't know when the fight's going to happen. UFC, 9 o'clock, the bell rings, you're fighting. Hockey, the puck drops. You might not, you know, you might prepare to fight, but it might not happen. So, you know, the ups and downs, the emotional roller coaster, people understand that stuff. And I thought the movie did a good job of touching on that, of just, you know, the mental side of, you know, such a physical, demanding portion of the game.
And listening to you, and, you know, I know that you were an assistant coach for, what, 8 years now?
With this is 7 years, yeah.
And the way that you describe teammates and players and how they used to berate them, and it seems like, I mean, it's almost natural for you to be a coach because you like you can read players and know, like, I remember in high school football, there would be guys where the coach would shit on them. I'd be like, oh, that's a dude you can't shit on. Like he's not going to respond to that. Like, is that something that came natural to you, or is it from being in locker rooms your whole life? Or you're like, it seemed like coaching just came immediately for you. You know, after you had retired, like you just walked right into it, and maybe it's because you care so much. You know, that you're able to do and break down and be like, well, this guy, you have to do it this way, and you know, this guy is going to work more if I push him a little bit more. Is that something that came naturally to you, I guess, is what I'm asking?
It did. And, you know, when I retired at 28, my physical body was breaking down, and Paul Holmgren had offered me this job. So I had another year of my contract, actually, which I, you know, turned it into a 4-year coaching deal. So I made a decision based on, you know, a few different things, mainly my physical body and my physical health was, you know, the biggest one. And, you know, going, you know, probably having to get sent down in the minors and fighting, you know, everyone and their brother. You know, I wasn't really having that at that time, you know. Going through some, you know, personal things and whatever else. But just, you know, kind of just who I am. You know, I think I've generally been a pretty compassionate person, more of a listener than a talker. And, you know, especially when I retired, I changed a lot of things in my life. I stopped drinking for a full year and, you know, started removing things, destructive things. And I think, you know, naturally my spirit became more compassionate. So I just wanted to really help people. And also in the coaching side, you know, you're dealing with 23 to 23 guys, managing character. I was, you know, the buffer zone to the head coach, just again, being a listener and trying to give them some sort of advice based on my experience of, like, you know, how to deal with certain things. And I loved it. And, I'm no longer coaching corporate sports, but I mean, the last 7 years, you know, that was exactly my role. I was, you know, just, you know, basically a a platform for guys to come to just to balance things off of my own personal experience, or, you know, how should I go talk to the coach or whatever, blah, blah, blah. But, you know, again, you know, just trying to instill, you know, whatever experience and wisdom that I had into them. And what I learned, though, you know, in the last 7 years is that, like, I've just you know, discovered a whole other element of helping people, and that's, you know, in the cannabis and hemp stuff that has been kind of like drawing at my heartstrings of like, which direction do I go? Because both really can't coexist. I can't support, you know, a banned substance and have a corporate job and, you know, a sports corporate job and it just doesn't exist. It just doesn't work. So I was kind of, you know, quietly positioning myself and educating and blah, blah, blah. What came to, you know, basically came to an end this summer where just they both couldn't coexist. But my point being is that, you know, on this other side of it, I'm able to help way more people with, you know, introducing them to cannabis and hemp, you know, derived cannabinoids, you know, especially in the sports market, the sports arena, in the hockey arena. I've seen so many guys, alumni guys, retired, that struggle with addiction and alcohol and opioid and Ambien or whatever the case may be. They struggle with identity and purpose. And then I look at, you know, the way they've been managing their ailments and injuries and all this stuff. And, you know, cannabis and hemp, these cannabinoids, if they're used and respected, are like the ultimate tool. So for me, it's like now I'm able to integrate a lot of my knowledge and experience through sports and being, you know, being a physical guy and get my face punched in and, you know, all this other stuff. Now I can speak on behalf of a solution for all people to manage their pain and anxieties and their sleep issues and all this other stuff with an alternative that's much more sustainable. Well, that is sustainable. Alcohol and opioids are certainly not sustainable.
Right.
And you know what I mean? And just better for, you know, the individual, public health and the environment. So, you know, to me, once I transitioned out, it was meant to be, you know what I mean? So now I'm able to, you know, integrate, like I said, the sports world and my passion of healing, natural healing. It's not just cannabis or hemp. I mean, there's other plants that roam this planet that have, you know, a plethora of them that have healing properties that we all include probably on a daily basis, whether we know it or not, but just focusing on healing. And, you know, as you said earlier, you know, a healer, and that's the way I look at myself. I introduced people to a different way of thinking and a different way to take care of themselves that's different than the status quo. I think we've been so trusting. And you said it earlier too, is like, I've always challenged, you know, society, or challenged things that people told me I couldn't do, because I believe that the mind is probably the most powerful tool, you know, around. That if you believe something and you put your mind and power to it, you can accomplish anything. And that's, you know, for me, being a non-fighter guy to fighting the heavyweights in the NHL, to going against the grain and, you know, seeing, you know, a plant like cannabis being one of the most extremely valuable tools, healing tools for all mankind, and, you know, standing up for what you believe in, really what it lands up being, and having a spine.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
You know, you know, I've had some haters, you know, but there's always going to be haters. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you're not getting away from them. You can't make everyone happy. There's always going to be people that just can't pull their head out of the sand. So, you know, I really try and do my thing with, you know, the cannabis and really kind of targeting the athletes, because now that's kind of my niche is that I'm able to not only help these guys, it's coaching in a different way, but it's helping these guys learn from the mistakes I made. I wasn't sustainable. Mm-hmm. I drank way too much. I partied way too much. You know, a lot of times I was in the morning at the rink in the morning, I was just trying to like survive and just steam out the alcohol and get a workout in just to kind of balance out what I did the night before. That's not sustainable.
No.
I mean, and eating a shitload of calories and a lot of empty calories and refined sugar, a lot of stuff that just, again, long term is not good for the human body and the mind. And you know, once you're able to integrate, you know, experience with players and you help these guys become more sustainable. So instead of retiring at 28, you can retire at 40. Like,
right.
Jim Dowd is, you know, is a good mentor of mine. He's like my centerman my first year in the NHL. This guy played in the NHL for 20 years. He played till he's 40. He broke his neck when he was 32, they told me to never play again. But this guy was right there with me, first guys in the morning. We'd stretch together and we'd talk, and you know what I mean? And you realize that you can be more sustainable. Eating healthy and finding these cannabinoids and all these other stuff aren't going to make you have Sidney Crosby skill level, but it might actually prevent an injury that you're actually not going to get removed out of the lineup for and make you more sustainable long term, because you're in the business of performance, and taking care of your physical body is much more important than your skill. Because if you don't have your health, don't matter how much skill you have.
Yeah, you have nothing.
It's kind of maximizing that, and that's really where I come into, is that I've learned the hard way, and I understand hockey, I understand the mentality of these guys, and so I'm able to kind of, you know, join forces and do both. And to me, it's been rewarding.
Was it seeing some of the, you know, guys that you had played with, you know, start, and we can't really get into it now, but I mean, the opioid addiction of this country and athletes is it breaks my heart. It really does. But is that something that made you start Athletes for Care? Is seeing some of, you know, guys that you had loved and played with go down this, and it's not their fault, because those things are, the opioids are just so addictive and just life wrecking that it's like a shit spiral that there's nothing they can do about it. And there's such this faux pas around cannabis and cannabinoids where, you know, from way back into the day, you know, you hear Joe Rogan talk about that guy all the time. I forget his name now, but where that hemp corticator came out and he had to like ban it because he was in the paper industry or whatever.
Yep.
But that whole issue of marijuana being this thing that, you know, it's going to make you rape white women and kill your neighbor. It's way better than it's ever been, but it has to stop now. Even when I tell people about CBD, they go, well, am I going to fail a drug test? I'm like, no. I'm like, well, it's illegal, right? I'm like, no. I mean, they're going to try to make it illegal because it's actually helping people. But you have to get up on this stuff. And what you're doing with Athletes for Care and Hemp Heals is beyond important to get people a natural way to heal themselves.
Yeah, you're exactly right. And that was pretty much the reason why I started, Athletes for Care specifically, was just seeing the way guys self-medicated, and, you know, being in the culture of hockey specifically, it was kind of drink beer, play hard, party harder type of attitude. And you know what I mean? And, you know, just tough it out and drink some beer. And, you know, that attitude is outdated. You know what I mean? It's like, it's not, it's good when you're young and you know what I mean? And you guys think it's a beauty thing to do and it's all cool. But like, you know, as you get older and you get close to 30 and 40 and 50, I mean, if you're still living that way, well, you obviously got an addiction at that point, because, I mean, or major substance abuse, because you can't go on like that.
Yeah.
So I see that. And I always say, like, prohibition of cannabis is the root cause of the opioid epidemic.
For
sure.
Because
what you've done is you've outlawed the alternative, and then you funneled people down the path of synthetic heroin.
Yeah. Opioid. Yeah.
So no choice. You know, the choice is to manage your pain legally, but unsustainably, and probably have an addiction, or run the risk of, you know, getting caught with a bag of weed and you know, having a possession charge, but you're not going to have an addiction. You know, you pay a fine and you hire a lawyer, but that's the gamble. That's what people always fight with on a daily basis. Do I do it legally and I sacrifice my soul and my spirit because, you know, I'm destructive nature of these things, or do I do what my spirit is actually wanting me to do, but I have to get over this morality issue and do it smart and wise, you know? And I'm not, you know, telling anybody to break the law by any means, but like, at some point, you as a spiritual being, you have to make decisions that feed the spirit.
Well, and
alcohol is a de-spiriter, and opioids are a de-spiriter, and a lot of the things we do on a daily basis that are legal habits are just terrible for society and public health, and we don't even really talk about them. Opioids, we are right now. We have an alcohol epidemic too.
Well,
and we don't talk about it like that because alcohol equates to sponsorships and money and fun. But mental health, dehydration, health. I mean, you talk about one of the worst things you can put in your body. And most people aren't drinking craft beer or, you know, artesian wines. You know, I mean, you know, made with organic grapes. They're eating like they're drinking like the Coors Light and the, you know what I mean? The piss ends of a keg and you know, nitrates and fillers and preservatives. And you know what I mean? Talk about even worse than the alcohol itself is just garbage. So we've just kind of become disconnected to what's, you know, culturally acceptable. And then you know, on the other side of it, we demonize the, the plant. But I mean, it's been a great job of brainwashing. The propaganda campaigns have done an unbelievable job because, 90 years later, we're still scared of it. But in saying that, they've put in rules that, should instill fear. I mean, if you're going to, sacrifice your job and sacrifice your children and they're going to dangle, incarceration over your head, like, yeah, that's real stuff. That's real life. And that is why we are doing what we're doing with Athletes Precarious, because that shouldn't happen. We should have the alternative. Like, if you want to have opioids for sale, well, at least have cannabinoids for sale.
Exactly.
At least people, like, make a choice.
Exactly.
But don't give them no option, or the only option is jail time. Because to me, that's a crime against humanity. And you've created this addiction. You've created this mess in the name of business. And that's a problem for me.
Well, if you took a piece of paper and fucking split it down the middle and wrote, the pros and cons of opioids and cannabis on either end, you would think it would be flipped. You would think that people would be – that the opioids would be illegal and they wouldn't be handing out prescriptions like it's nothing. That doctor-patient relationship, they don't give a fuck what you're going to do with your life. They can give you 300, Percocets and send you on your way because they get paid by the Percocet company to give them to you.
Yep.
So it doesn't matter if you fall down a hole and get addicted to them, because you're coming back for your script to give them more money so that they can put air in their Audi and drive to some weird place where they do something. I have no idea. But it doesn't make sense. And like you had just mentioned in your last point there, that if, and I believe fully that people should be able to do whatever they want as long as you're not harming another person. So if you want to do opioids or opiates, that's fine. I don't care. If you want to do Percocets until your nose bleeds, go for it. But you should have the option and the knowledge and the education to maybe get a vape pen or take some CBD or, have marijuana legalized where you can smoke it and feel better. There should be that option.
There absolutely should be. And you look at models like Portugal, they legalized all drugs like 10, 12 years ago. And what happens when you do that is that violent crime goes down, organized crime goes down, substance abuse goes down, because now you're treating these patients, as like a public health, as a public health issue versus a criminality issue. Instead of incarcerating people for their drug addiction, you actually give them help. And that model here in America could work if you actually gave it a shot. Because right now it's like we're incarcerating people for the safest, most healing tool, but then we just flood the market and flood the streets with alcohol and opioids and other prescription drugs and all this other garbage that we get hooked on. So the system is set up for failure. We're inflicting addiction and we're inflicting a massive crisis on public health on purpose, and and demonizing us for the healing tool because it interferes with business. And once you understand that, understand prohibition, and understand some of these compounds that exist that are extremely destructive, and how we've gotten to where we are today. It's not by accident.
No.
It's perfectly calculated. And I grew up in Winnipeg. We have outside of Winnipeg, and you're blending into Saskatchewan outside of Manitoba. Even is a huge Aboriginal community. If you look at from an Aboriginal's perspective of them sitting on their land and doing what they did back in the day, and all of a sudden it's like the white man comes in and infiltrates them with alcohol and basically de-spirits once once the most spiritual one of the most spiritual people on the planet. And now what you see is you have reservations full of addiction, and you've essentially wiped out the spirit of these very spiritual people, and that wasn't done by accident. And you see that in mainstream society of, like, whether you talk about alcohol addiction, opioid addiction, caffeine addiction, or refined sugar addiction, we don't talk about that one because it's beyond legal. It's refined sugar, and genetically modified sugar is in all of our foods. So we just accept that. So when we become 300, 400, 500 pounds, we accept that as just genetics, or this is the bad balance, or whatever. But it's like we don't talk about addiction as the same across the board. We just lump Schedule One drugs in, or the obvious ones in together. But we don't explain the difference between a substance and a substance and a substance. But most people don't know that, you know, refined sugar sparks the brain 8 times more than cocaine. And there's a reason why Coca-Cola and these companies put cocaine and sugar water back in the day. Now it's just sugar water and caffeine. And you know what I mean? You create customers because these people keep coming back to you because they're using a highly addictive product.
Right.
You know, so it's just like if you go to your doctor for pain management, if he's giving you a synthetic opioid versus, you know, cannabis, I can assure you that 100 times out of 100 that the person that's going to use the opioid is probably much more danger of becoming an addict or a junkie versus the guy that's going to take the cannabis and he's going to manage his stressors and anxieties and sleep all with one plant. He doesn't have to have 10 pills or 10 different types of pills. So, again, it's education. We have to change the way we think. It's a complex issue, but it's a very simple issue at the same time, where we just got to reconnect the natural world and understand that Mother Nature has gifted us all these valuable tools, healing tools, food. You know, let food be thy medicine, medicine be thy food. Like, this is ancient ways of thinking. This is not new age stuff. This is just getting back the basics. I think the Industrial Revolution has kind of polluted us and corroded our way of thinking, where now we're just thinking that, you know, the man's going to magically come up with the cure and all this stuff. Well, we've created the problem. We've created the disease. We've inflicted the disease and the addiction. And now, you know, who's coming to save the day? Well, Mother Nature's going to save the day, because that's what Mother Nature does. You know what I mean? It's not man, I can assure you.
Yeah. And it would be so easy to flip it the other way if there wasn't so much money, in business, like you had mentioned, involved in it. And it all boils down to liberty. People, there's no reason that cannabis is illegal, especially with all the research that is now that helps people. And I know, for instance, it helped your sister, a ton, didn't it?
Oh yeah, absolutely. She was on traditional medicine for MS for 8 years. I forget what drugs they were, but the 3 or 4 different drugs she alternated with. It was injections in her leg. And eventually, it was kind of like working to some degree and plateauing, but then, you know, eventually your body would get used to it. And then eventually she would switch her medicines, and then eventually she couldn't even get the needles in her legs anymore. Well, that's when she was like, only 28, 29 or something at the time. She just says, well, I can't live like this and go on the rest of my life, you know, like this. And that was, you know, I was already kind of engaging her on alternative natural healing methods, including cannabis and stuff like that. She was hesitant. We grew up in a very religious family. So she was like, blah, blah, blah. So eventually she, you know, got over all that, and she's been using it for 6-7 years now, different strains, CBD, more CBD heavy and dominant towards the evening or during the day, and then, you know, THC towards the evening and into the night. So she's figured out what works for her. It gets a ton of relief from that. And also, in saying that, she's also done other things to help with her MS as well. She's removed inflammatory foods. Such as dairy is high anti-inflammatory. A lot of things that promote inflammation, especially when you're dealing with an inflammatory disease.
Diet's so important.
Yeah, it really is. And what I always say too is it's not always what you add or do. It's what you remove and don't do. That's probably equally as important, if not more important. Because again, we bombard our bodies and our minds with all kinds of crap that we don't take any, we're not mindful at all about, that, you know, affect us. And we just kind of do it in accumulation and accumulation and accumulation. Eventually it adds up. So, you know, once you remove certain things, your body responds very positively. And, you know, especially when you're managing an inflammatory disease. So, I can speak for myself in my own personal, you know, journey with nutrition. And, you know, once I started removing certain things, and, you know, specifically alcohol and refined sugar and dairy, those three alone, whey protein, which we're so conditioned to consume. Once you remove those types of things, your body is like, it goes into this whole other state of being, because, you know, whey protein is essentially the piss ends of the cheese industry that grind up into fluff and sell as a powder. He's talking about inflammation and acidity to the body. And then you look at refined sugar that's in everything. It's a heavy, inflammatory food. And once you start removing the things that cause inflammation, your body heals, and it heals really quick too. And then on top of that, he's adding anti-inflammatory properties such as cannabis and hemp and turmeric and ginger and all these other healing foods. You know what I mean? So it's like a double whammy. became extremely passionate about this, you know, specifically when my sister got diagnosed with MS, that really started, you know, really kind of jump-started my, you know, my research and just started reading books and exploring and you know, and then I had my own experience with cannabis, and then everything's kind of validated through the science now that is available. So it's a good time to be alive.
Oh, it is. It's the best time to be alive. And that's what people always have to remember. And it's never been better to be a human and walking on the planet. It just hasn't been. There's a lot of bad shit going on, but there's so many things and information where you can live a great life and be happy. You might just have to read a little bit and research and find out what's important to you. And, you know, you don't always have to just go work for 70 hours a week. You can just say no and do something else. I mean, you'll find a way to survive. As a human, you will go on. It will happen.
Exactly. Yeah. And we're all spiritual beings, and we're all growing. And if you're not growing, you're dying. So, like, as part of the spirituality is finding the truth and seeking the truth, right? If you just took everything for a grain of salt, which most people do, we're just kind of brainwashed beings. We just, you know, take everything for face value. But, you know, part of the journey is to challenge the belief system, and, you know what I mean, and find a better way, because there is a better way. And yes, we are living probably the best times that the man has ever been, with the most freedoms, but we can still do better.
Yeah.
And we can always do better. You know what I mean? Yeah. That's what I mean. How can we be living in a country of freedom if we don't have cannabis, if plants are outlawed? You know what I mean? It's like, it's especially weird. Healing plants that can help so many people. So there's so much more work to do. And it's all about increasing quality of life. But yes, we're living the best times. As much negative press as you see, and as much evil as there is on the planet, that's not going away.
No.
It's always going to be there. So you have to change your perspective and focus on the positives and really jumpstart your spiritual journey, because that's what it is. And start asking questions and seeking answers. If you're in pain, don't take, you know, traditional protocols word for it, because there's something better, I can assure you. And, you know, we've been using Mother Nature and Mother Nature's resources forever, and now we've just exploited them in the name of business and patented medicine and you know, misinformation and sideline science and all this other stuff, where it's a business. It's not about what's good for people. It's not about public health. It's just about damage control. And once we realize that, oh, this chemical is causing this disease or this and this, and we pull it off the shelf, we'll remove that. And then, you know what I mean? It's damage control after the fact, once people get sick. You know what I mean? Look at it. We can't even have clean water here in America. We got Flint. We got water crises everywhere.
Oh.
How can that be in 2018? How can we not have clean water in the most industrialized country on the planet?
It comes down to money, man. I mean,
well, it doesn't matter. It just doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It's damage control. We're just going to settle for a lawsuit and give you a couple cases of Dasani water and call it a piece. You know what I mean? It's like that's how we roll. It's like, you know, it's like there's oil spills and all this other stuff that are polluting, polluting people's communities and water, you know,
factory farming, water
supply and all this stuff. And what do you do? It's just like, oh, we'll just clean it up. And sorry about that. My bad. You know, it's just like, so to me, there's a better way. You know, when you get into the hemp stuff, environmental stuff, like there's better way. There's more sustainable ways to do energy. Like fossil fuels are outdated.
Yeah.
Clean coal doesn't exist. There's no such thing as clean coal. It's just fossil fuels. I mean, we got to get to more wind and solar and growing hemp. Hemp is energy. Hemp has the same the hemp fiber has the same properties as copper. It can conduct and store energy. Most people don't know that. You know what I mean? So we look at, you know, you look at this from a bigger perspective of just, more of an environmental and a global perspective, not just public health. I mean, we could prevent a lot of these diseases by not polluting our planet and our people, and then having to force them down poisonous paths with poisonous medicine. You know, we could change that model by being more sustainable, you know, and it's probably not going to happen in my time. We're not going to see the full transformation, but we're going to self-destruct otherwise. And you see it. We have more disease now than ever. And we're supposed to be more advanced and progressive than ever. So something's wrong.
Well, thank goodness for people like you that are getting this ball rolling and, you know, pushing forward and getting the information out to people. Especially, you know, there will be people that would be more inclined to listen to a former athlete. I mean, there's people in Philly that won't give a fuck if an athlete from Philly didn't say it. They don't care. That's just the way they live. And there's nothing wrong with that, but it's important for guys that, for anybody who has a belief or feels important or strongly about something to actually speak up, say something, and do something about it. So what you're doing is it's very important, and I'm behind you, and everyone here at the Biscuit is behind you 100%. And you know, it's amazing, and it's helped me. I mean, since I've been taking CBD, even mentally, I feel better. I'm not as stressed out. I'm sleeping better. My bones, my hands feel better. I just feel more like I should. It feels good. I feel good.
Yeah, well, that's exactly it. It's all about just general well-being. It's increasing quality of life. So most people don't know we have an endocannabinoid system that's actually, you know, mimics the immune system, that has receptors for the cannabis and hemp plant. CB1, CB2 receptors for these cannabinoids. So they're in the brain, they're in the gut, they're in every part of the body. So when you consume CBD or THC or any sort of, you know, cannabinoid, it really targets the whole body. So whether you have an acute pain in your knee, you have anxiety, or you have sleep issues, that same product will take care of all of it, versus the pharma model, which is like one pill for that, one pill for that, one pill for that, where the cannabis and hemp plant can take care of all that. You know, again, it has its calming effects on the nervous system, manages anxiety, promotes, you know, calmness for sleep, promotes sleep, helps with inflammation, helps with pain. And then, you know, on the neuroprotectant side, protects brains, you know, brain cells, and promotes brain cell growth, the neurogenesis. So to me, that's all part of the recovery process. And that's why I always call it the ultimate recovery tool. And when you look at it from an athlete's perspective or not, you know, we're in the business of repairing as quickly as we can. It's work versus recovery. Wake up in the morning, you got to practice, you got a pregame skate, or you got a game that evening. You got to prepare for that game, and it starts the recovery process. In the real world, it's no different. You're not in the physical performance of sports, but you still got to wake up in the morning. You still got to do your job. You still got to be alert. You still got to be focused. You still got to have clarity. And you still got to do all these things and manage your family and bring balance and the rest of it. So to me, it's a simple swap out of, just managing all these conditions. You know, stress has got to be the biggest killer on the planet.
Yeah.
And these types of things help with stress and anxiety, and, you know, bring balance. And it's all about bringing balance. We all are juggling, you know, probably way too much in our lives. You know, we got families, we got jobs, we got side jobs, we got hustle, we got this and that. And we overstress ourselves. So if we can manage stress, you know, sustainably, and manage our anxieties and everything else sustainably, we don't run in the risk of, you know, leaning on opioids and alcohol and these other things to manage and self-medicate with, because we have the alternative, you know, and people are seeking that. But again, there's a lot of fear and there's a lot of propaganda that still exists.
For sure.
From kind of hopping over the fence.
Have you experimented or tried Kratom at all?
You know, I have not.
I haven't either.
But I heard some really positive things, especially for people that are trying to get off opioids.
Exactly.
And manage your pain that way. So
yeah, I have, you know, friends and family that are where, you know, opioids are a part of their life, and I'm trying to find a way to be like, hey, you should try Kratom. But if I haven't tried it myself, it's hard to like push it upon them or be like, hey, you should try this. I never have, but I don't know. I'd like to maybe get some more information on that. I know I have a buddy that he drinks it every morning, and it seems to help, just to feel better. So, I mean, if there's something that grows out of a tree and can help you, I think it would be better than getting addicted to
exactly. To me, like I stay in my lane, I haven't used that, but I've heard a lot of stories of people that have. And to me, anything is better than synthetic opioids.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's like, let's be serious here. And from what I understand, it kind of mimics the opioid receptors in a sense, where it's, but naturally. So it's certainly better for sure.
Oh, is that little Miss Cote right here?
There's the grocery store. So.
I get two guest stars today.
Hey, am I on camera here or just all recording?
We're just on recording.
Okay, my daughter's wearing a Flyers jersey right now because we're playing a Flyers alumni game later today. So that's awesome.
I wish we were on camera just so I could see that. That'd be awesome.
Yeah. So, yeah.
Cool, man. Well, I just got a couple more for you, and I'll let you get on your way here. I want you to just say, to explain CBD. Just tell everybody, because everybody's so afraid to take it that it's not illegal. and it's okay. It'll make you feel better. Just I think hearing it from you will just and you know and they can go to you know Parker's Platoon sells it on .org and Receptra, and maybe if they hear it from you and not me, everybody thinks it's illegal. It's not, right?
No, and you guys are in Canada, so I think the laws are a little bit different.
In America, man.
Oh, yeah, okay, so basically, yeah, so the loophole is you got medical cannabis or resinous or recreational cannabis on one side, and that's really involving a higher amounts of THC, above 0.3% THC. Then you got the other side of the plant, in the industrial hemp side of the plant, that has to be grown below 0.3% THC. But the THC molecule and the CBD molecule are the same no matter what plant they come from. So the loophole is that since industrial hemp grows below 0.3% THC, it has has no psychoactivity. So all the cannabinoids meaning a compound within cannabis, about I think 140 discovered. So CBD being the main ones, cannabidiol, non-psychoactive. So you consume this product just much like a nutraceutical or something you buy at GNC or a health food store. And, you know, most of the same exact properties you get from resinous cannabis to THC version without the high and without the munchies. So you get the anti-inflammatory, you get the, you know, the pain management, you get the sleep, the recovery. And I truly believe there's a proponent for THC, but we're talking about CBD derived from industrial hemp.
Yeah.
Sold across state line under the Federal Farm Act, 2014-7606, a Farm Act, where it's an industrial hemp crop, not a medical cannabis crop. So it's not considered, I don't like to use the word marijuana anyways, but it's not marijuana.
Right,
it's hemp.
Right.
So,
right.
But the cannabinoids derived from hemp are the same molecules that are derived cannabis. So. It's just lots of education. You know what I mean? That's most people, you know, they're on the fence of cannabis or cannabinoids. Like, go non psychoactive. That should solidify it, right? I mean,
because
everyone's kind of so afraid of the demonized THC molecule. If that's what you're afraid of, there's options that are non psychoactive.
And
topicals, sublinguals, suppositories, transdermal patches, and my wife takes it every night. She's not a cannabis smoker, but she uses CBD every night just to calm her nerves and just to put her to sleep. You know, it's just
it's the best.
It's the best.
You know, it is the best.
You know,
and
the quality of life increases, and they're just like, what the heck? Where was this? You know, 10, 15 years ago, type stuff. You know.
Now I used to be able to smoke. You know, when I was younger, it's illegal now. So for my day job, I can't. But my favorite part of CBD, because of the state I live in, it's illegal. The United States is weird. You know that parts of it, it's legal. Parts of it's not. Anyway, that when I take that the higher milligram, it tastes like smoking cannabis. And it's so good. It just that puts a smile on your face alone. You're just like – it kind of like sends you back like, oh, yeah, I remember this. Like, this is great.
Well, yeah, you know what? Some of the hemp extracts that I've tried, you know, do taste exactly like that. Because I mean, ultimately, you know, the hemp variety is just a different varietal of, you know, of the resinous cannabis plant. It's ultimately still cannabis. It's just grown differently for different purposes. So, you know, naturally have that taste and that and a little bit of that smell is great. I mean, I feel the same way. I really do like that smell, and it's something earthy and grounding about it.
Oh yeah.
But you know, people that really don't know it or haven't been really introduced to it, they're not really too sure what to make of it. You know what I mean? Because it is a different smell, and it is skunky, and it does have a little bit of a taste of some of these sublinguals. But nonetheless, I mean, it's a small price to pay, you know, for long term sustainable health. But it is, like you said, it's all about increasing quality of life. Just general well being. You just kind of take a load off. You feel better. Everything feels better. It's hard to explain to people
I can't recommend enough to people just to try it. Just try it. You're not going to lose anything. It's not going to hurt you. You're not going to get sick. You're not going to fail a drug test. Just try some CBD oil, and I swear that it'll have a positive impact on your life. I promise you. I tell anybody that asks me about it. I said, just try it. Here, I'll give you some. Just try it.
Yeah, exactly. And the people that are like really on the fence, that really don't even want to touch it, I just like say, like, how much pain are you in then? Like, how bad do you really need it? Because, like, to me, if I I've met a lot of people that really struggle, like really struggle with pain and all kinds of different stuff. They don't know what direction to go. Like, at some point, you got to make a decision. Like, well, I want to make a decision to be feeling better, and you know, I want to increase my quality of life. I don't want to succumb to this, you know, this really negative, painful feeling that I wake up to every morning. You know what I mean? At some point, you just got to get over your belief system and just accept that you've been fundamentally misled and just move on. You know what I mean? This is gonna help you out.
And even all the studies now about ibuprofen, where like it's like poison to your liver, it like lowers your sperm count, like
rots out your stomach and everything else.
Yeah, it ruins your gut biome. Exactly. Like where, and people are, I see people shovel that shit in their face like it's nothing. I'm like, whoa. You're just taking that because you think it's okay. Like, yeah. I'm taking one drop from a vial of CBD in the morning, and I don't have to take that. I do not take ibuprofen. I will not.
Yeah, you and me both. And that's exactly it. It's philosophy on what you deem is actually a healing tool. Like, to me, eating Tylenol or Advil or any of that stuff
freaks me out.
It's toxic, man. You know what I mean? I don't
know what that stuff is, man. I can't go to the Tylenol bush and pull something off. Like, it creeps me out.
Yeah. No, and that's the stuff that we put our blind faith in, is deemed as, oh, it's sold above the counter at the pharmacy, it must be okay, it must be safe. It's like, no, it's not safe.
No, it's not safe.
It's not something you want to take long term, I mean, or ever, really. I mean, especially if there's an alternative. Take the stuff that doesn't destroy your liver. Take the stuff that doesn't destroy your spirit, and take the stuff that you can take forever, and you're not going to develop an addiction, and you can manage, you know, your anxieties and your stressors in life without that negative side.
There is an alternative, man. That's so important. All right, man. This is my last question for you. What are you afraid of?
Probably afraid of letting people down.
Oh, man.
I used to be afraid. I think I've actually learned in life that you have to face your fears.
Yeah.
So I grew up hating public speaking, and now I love public speaking. So I put myself out there and actually try to get better at it, reading books and getting experience. Coaching helped, but I actually do a lot of public speaking events now. I actually really, really enjoy it. So that was one of my fears, and I faced it. My next one is – well, my other one was not that I was bullied as a kid at all, but I just, like, there was something about me that I wanted to never have that happen to me, or, like, you know, you know, people that were, you know, tough guys in schools, and there was some gang guys and whatever else. I always wanted to be able to earn my credibility and show that I was tough without having to be a tough guy, you know, around them at school and stuff like that. I think I did that, you know, earning some street credit, you know, fighting and hockey and stuff like that. Oh, yeah. So that was like a fear of mine that I kind of faced. But I think, you know, I think right now I just have so many things going on, and it's all in the name of helping people that I just, like, I just want to help as many people as I can. So I feel like, you know, sometimes I take on too much and I feel like I let people down. That's I think that's my biggest fear. It's like not maximizing my opportunities here now, which I know I'll be all right, because I always am. But it's just like, you know, you think about it, it's like I got a lot riding here. I'm doing a lot of stuff that's, you know, very alternative, and you know what I mean. I just want to make sure I maximize this moment and this opportunity, because it is different. It's different, you know, certainly different direction than most people, are headed or are in. So, you know, but I know I'll be all right. It's all positive. It's all going the right direction. Just a lot of, you know, uncertainty in a very unstable, quasi legal market. You know what I mean? So, yeah. It's all going the right direction. It's just kind of ups and downs along the way.
For sure. And you know, no homo, but you're an inspiration to me, man. I see you out there working, plugging away, and you know, now I feel worse because you're afraid of public speaking. You're just killing it out there doing that. But guys like you and Scott Parker, who's helping out veterans, and you're helping out, you know, an entire culture of people that are looking for an alternative, and you're really just out there going, because you see, and you know, if you follow you on Instagram or Twitter or anything, like, oh, I'm in Colorado today, I'm in Seattle here, now I'm back in Philly, I'm all over the place just trying to help people, man. It really is an inspiration. and you're really using the platform that you've created for yourself through hard work and determination to help other people. And there's a lot of people that are put in that place and don't do something positive like that. So my hat's off to you, man. I really appreciate it. I really, really appreciate you coming on the show. I've learned a lot, and I'm sure the listeners have too. And a lot of my fan base is fans of, you know, Fighting From Hockey. So a lot of people were very excited when I said that, you know, Riley Cote was going to be on today. But I thank you. I thank you for your time and your sacrifice to a sport that I love very much and means a lot to people. And then your research and, you know, speaking as you move forward.
Awesome. Thanks. And I just want to plug one thing I got going on.
Absolutely. Plug away, man.
Scott Parker and I are coming out with our own CBD brand here in the next 2 months. So
hell yeah.
On the lookout, and we're going to really attack, and you know, not that it has to be specific to the hockey market, but that would obviously be our starting point. We got some connections in the UFC, but you know, contact sports, just showing, you know, showing how you can manage all these ailments we do on a daily basis with something sustainable. So maybe we'll hop back on in the future once we're launched together, me and Parks, and talk about it.
For sure, man. I got to talk to him a couple weeks ago, and we were talking about guys that both of you had fought, and I was like, holy shit, man, you guys, it's just insane what you guys did, man. Some of the monsters, I mean, you guys are monsters yourselves, but it's just crazy, some of the guys you guys had to fight.
Oh, yeah.
And where, cool. You got some camps coming up, don't you? And that's another thing I want to say, not to hold up any more of your time, but, like, you know, through the corporation coaching, you can't really do anymore, but helping kids. And I have daughters. I have two daughters, and you have a daughter that – even helping girls with hockey too, man. That's – you're just killing it out there, man.
Yeah, that's kind of where I fit in. I think in the hockey space now is doing coaching on my own time, do a lot of stuff in the youth hockey space, do my own camps and clinics. But I'm able to, you know, carve out my own schedule. I'm not locked down from a full season schedule. So that's nice, and I still get on the ice, you know, 3-4 times a week with kids, and again, educating them, just, you know, same stuff that I would obviously with younger kids, a lot of them, but you know, just kind of giving a different perspective of things to think of, because they all think about just hockey as just scoring goals, but not,
yeah,
you know, not checking the right way, or not stick position, or not you know, doing things more efficiently and stuff like that. So just always just, whatever, plugging in any sort of knowledge that I have on this different stuff. But it's more, for now anyways, in my life, I'm able to do that as well as, you know, basically work two passions simultaneously.
Absolutely. Tell the listeners where to find you on Twitter and Instagram and such.
Twitter, it's Riley Coyote, RileeCoyote. The same goes for Instagram, and then Riley, I think it's Riley Cote on Facebook there, just standard. So,
well, Riley, thank you so much for coming on, man. Good luck in your alumni game, and I really appreciate you taking the time to come talk to me and talk to the listeners, man. I really, really appreciate it.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
All right, buddy.
Take care.
Yep, take care. How many bucks do I give?